tweaks on that.
I forgot.
Was really short. Helpful.
talking about swimming, we forgot to push forward. My fault. I'll go back and introduce you and stuff, but let's keep going. So
okay. But yeah, so just getting some tweaks in the form and swimming, I think, made my stroke more efficient. I definitely started feeling faster in the water.
Yeah.
So that was the biggest change there. On the bike, it was really more of just getting some more time, particularly on the triathlon bike. I had an older triathlon bike that I hadn't been riding pretty much since COVID when I got a road bike. So getting comfortable again on the triathlon bike was definitely a little bit of an adjustment, and just, you know, spending more time on that bike. And then also the structure of the longer workouts in particular, I think was a big thing for me, because I was familiar with structured workouts, shorter ones. I'd been doing a lot of Zwifting, especially during COVID, but longer rides was usually just kind of meet up with a group and, you know, ride, you know, not really focusing on, you know, long intervals. And I was riding with a power meter, but not focusing on, at least on the longer rides, about, you know, staying in different zones and that kind of stuff. So that was, that was probably the biggest thing for biking. And then for running, it was definitely back to form. Kind of like swimming, I had a good foundation for running coming in. I've been doing half marathons and marathons for 7 or 8 years. I was comfortable with the long distance and with the endurance aspect of it, but my form definitely needed some work. I'm still, you know, still working on that even after a few months. So definitely some more room for improvement, but that was, I think, the biggest thing there.
Yeah. So there was definitely things. I mean, the thing I want to point out is you were already a triathlete. You're going through the motions, but these are the little things that are going to get you to that next level. That right? I mean, would you say that those are the things? Because you already knew how to do a constructive workout. You know, already knew how to follow a training plan. So that was not something that was out of your wheelhouse. But having the extra attention and having the individual sessions to where we pointed out, okay, your bend, your right foot points way out to the side, you're losing a lot of power with every foot strike, or for your swimming, you're crossing over, and on the bike, your power meter, you had your power zones, but again, focusing more on delivering the type of workouts you need to succeed on a hilly bike course when you live in Miami, right? So you know, those were all things that I put into place. And did you ever have a bike fit as well with Dennis?
I think you did. Yeah, I had a bike fit.
Yeah. So making sure you're in the best position to produce the most amount of power and be comfortable, right? So all those things need to be put together. And then of course the work needs to be done, obviously. And like I said, you never had an excuse about why you couldn't get your work done, even though you were busy with work and you got a new puppy, you know?
Yeah.
I remember all that. So yeah. So let's talk about race day, because you had, okay, let's do your TriCalc 3, because I love it when an athlete fills out their TriCalc 3 and they really deliver the result within a few minutes of our TriCalc, right? So what was your TriCalc 3? That's, if for you guys that don't know, that's an app I use, www.tricalc3.com. And it just helps my athletes and myself kind of have a timeline for how they're going to do on race day. And so I love using it. And the more specific you are and the more dialed in you are with the exact times you think you're going to hit, the more likely you're going to hit them, right? So what was your TriCalc 3 overall time for the 70.3?
So I had a few different ones. My goal when I started was I wanted to finish in about 5.5 hours, just from doing the rough math in my head. I figured that's an achievable goal.
Yeah.
I think my final one was right around 5:30. It might've been 5:32. I had one that was like 5:28. So it was, you know, I had like the aggressive estimate and the conservative estimate, but it was right about 5.5 hours. And I finished, I think it was 5:30:50.
Yes. That's pretty awesome, I would have to say, especially on a longer distance race, is you have so many more things that can go wrong and so many more things that can happen. So for you to deliver within, you know, 2 minutes of your goal, either way, on the conservative and the slower one, that's pretty awesome. So I'm pretty happy that you were able to deliver on that. But let's talk about the race itself, because it was Haines City just 2 weeks ago. And I know they started the race later than they were supposed to because of whatever, weather or something.
What fog. Was the
It was fog. Okay, that's
It was real foggy every morning. So I think it was, I don't know if it was just for the swim that they wanted to delay and let the sun burn off the fog, or if it was also they didn't want people starting the bike course
right
with it being foggy.
Yeah, that would be super dangerous. That makes sense. Yeah, so that's cool. But what that what ended up happening though, because of that, it was way hotter on the run, right? Than we expected. Yeah. We were hoping for like 70s the whole run, and it ended up being in the 90s, right?
I don't know what the exact temperature was, but it was definitely, I mean, it was at least in the mid 80s. And I'm sure with the sun, it was, you know, heat index in the 90s. It was hot.
Yeah, it was hot. So that also always plays a factor, because sometimes when we luck out, when it's a cooler race and you can actually have faster run times just because it's cooler. But when it's normal conditions, just like Miami, you know, you're used to it. So it's not a big deal, right? So tell us about the swim. How did the swim go?
The swim was great. You know, growing up a pool swimmer, I'm much more comfortable in the pool. Yeah. I'm okay with open water, but it's never been my favorite part of a race. Uh-huh. But this one just seemed to go smoothly. I was able to get into a really nice rhythm early on. It was only my second or third swim in the wetsuit. You know, with some tips that you gave me about, you know, bunching it up in the shoulders and, you know, just making sure it's fit properly, that wasn't even a problem. I wasn't even thinking about it. The water temperature was great. And I kind of liked, you know, this race has a really unique swim course. They call it the M. You swim out to a corner, then come back about halfway, and then go back out to the far end of the lake, and then come back to the finish.
Yeah.
So you're making a lot of turns, which actually kind of helps, because it helped me break up the swim. So it's like, all right, I got to get to the far end of the lake, and then it's all right, I got to get back to the middle, rather than thinking, oh, I have, you know, 1.2 miles total to go.
Right.
So that went really smooth, and the swim portion, I was actually pretty far under my target. You know, I was conservative in estimating my swim time, because my pool times versus my race times, my pool times are much faster. So I didn't want to use, you know, my average per 100 yards in the pool as my estimate for the swim during the race. So I went a little bit slower, but I guess, you know, combination of the wetsuit and just feeling good in the swim, I was, I think, about 6 minutes under my target time. Awesome. So that, you know, getting out of the water, I already felt good knowing, you know, I'm ahead of schedule.
Yeah, that's a good feeling when you look at your watch and you're like, oh man, that's awesome. Yeah. I feel good, right?
Well, in the swim, it's different because, you know, on the bike and the run, you can constantly monitor your time.
Yeah.
Whereas in the swim, it's kind of just like, all right, I feel like I'm at a good pace. I feel like I'm pushing, but not so hard that I'm going to blow up, you know, something I can maintain for 35 to 40 minutes. So then to get out of the water and look at the watch and see that I was, you know, finishing much faster than expected was a great feeling.
Yeah. So what happens also is you don't really consider it, but the drafting, I mean, there is, when you're in a race with 2000 people, there is a lot of drafting happening. I mean, there's just the flow, but you know, that race has a lot of turns, but still you do, if you tap into someone getting behind someone, that can help you. The wetsuit definitely makes you faster. So the combination of all those, that's awesome. Okay. So how did the bike go? Cause the bike is challenging. It's hilly, you know, and we train flat, right? Yeah.
It's hilly, but it's not, you never have any really long climbs.
Right.
And there's only one or two sections that it gets really steep. So it's mostly, you know, punchy, short little climbs.
Yeah.
And, you know, I've, like you said, in Miami, we don't really have any hills. We have the bridge, which I think is like 3% incline. And at
it's 8% on.
Oh, it is?
And it's 6 to 7% coming back towards the city. It is. It's a good climb.
But it's short. It's really short. So, short, you know, we don't get any extended, unless you're doing repeats on it, you don't get, you know, a lot of hills in any training session. But I've done a considerable amount of hills on Zwift. So I'm, you know, comfortable with, you know, with that increased resistance.
Yeah.
And with kind of the, you know, an undulating course, which I think helped me in this race, because, you know, the beginning is a lot of downhill and flat.
Yeah.
And then it's kind of right after the halfway point is when you get into the lumpier portion. So the first half went great, you know, seemed to go by really fast. And by the time I got into the hills, you know, I was getting a little uncomfortable in the saddle. It had been a while, but knowing that I had actually done the course virtually before on Ruvi.
Yeah.
And then, you know, knowing I had gotten through 60 mile training rides with much higher average power output.
For sure.
You know, I was able to tell myself, you know, you can get through this. Just, you know, go And you told me break up the race into 18 mile segments.
Yes.
And so that's what I was doing mentally, just breaking it up into chunks and trying to keep it manageable.
That's awesome. Yeah. We knew you could deliver on the run. I mean, honestly, your run form wasn't as good as we would want it to be. It's still mm-hmm. much better. I mean, I took video of you yesterday at the track. I mean, you've improved so much as far as your symmetry from right to left. Like, it's so, so, so much better. So I know that helped you, and I knew you were going to be able to deliver on the run, but if you push too hard on the bike, you can't show up and do your run, right? So you must have had the sweet spot, but did you have any challenges on the run? Because it is also a hilly run.
Yeah. So I got it back into transition and was so excited to be done with the bike.
Yes.
Got off the bike and started to try to jog through transition to my rack.
Yeah.
And I had this pain in my right foot, like the outside of my right foot. I just could not jog. So I was like, all right, I'm just going to take my time through this transition.
Yeah.
Hopefully this will go away. It still bothered me a little bit in the first, mile or so of the run, mm-hmm. but the first mile was okay. I mean, I was tired. I knew it was going to be challenging, but I don't think you really hit any of the big hills until you get past the first mile.
Right.
Mile 2 and 3 were a struggle. My quad started cramping, going up hills. You're directly in the sun. It's hot. And I'm just thinking, oh, I have, 11, 12 miles to go. I'm never going to be able to finish this in the time I wanted.
Right.
And especially the leg cramps, knowing that my legs were cramping already in mile 2, I'm thinking by mile 10, 11, it's going to be over. I can push through a few miles, but I can't push through 10 or 11.
Right.
But you had told me before the race, when we knew it was going to be a little bit hotter, think about getting some salts, especially for the run, which I'd never, really used before, even in training. So I was a little bit nervous about trying something new on race day, but I got some, had them at my transition area. And right before I started off the run, I was like, let me just grab those just in case.
Yay.
And that saved me. I started taking some before every aid station, and the cramping didn't totally go away, but it was much more manageable. Able to push through it. It wasn't something that made me have to stop and walk. I was, after the first mile, I was thinking, I'm going to have to stop and just walk every aid station and then, run in between.
Yeah.
And after I started taking the salts, I was like, no, I can push through this. So the run ended up being a little bit slower than I had planned.
Right.
But it was still a time that I was happy with and, got me in right around my target. And thanks to that cushion I built up during the swim, the transitions and the bike were basically right on my predictions. So the combination of a faster swim and a little bit slower run put me in right on target. Yeah.
But I gotta commend you, because this is what long course racing is about, is strategy while you're in the moment, right? Mm-hmm. If you can avoid like the spiral, like you were like, okay, this might happen. Like, I might end up walking, but you grabbed your salt, right? So you like took action on what you knew you had control over and knew you could figure out, and you changed, right? You changed mm-hmm. from, okay, I'm not gonna be like, oh no, I can do it. Some people get stuck and they don't get out of the, no, it's not, I can't do it, right? Even though they've actually fixed or adjusted something. There's so many logistics on race day in a 70.3 or an Ironman. And if you're not able to have that faculty of, okay, let me try this, or whatever it is, you're not going to be able to show up and across the finish line at your desired goal, right? You're not going to be able to meet those expectations. There's always going to be a challenge. I will tell you, there's no Ironman, half Ironman athlete that has ever crossed the finish line and said, oh, that was the perfect race. Every single thing worked out perfectly. There's too many variables, right? Too many moving parts. You're human and it's just longer. You're out there four or five, 6 hours, right? For the half. So, good job on just saying, keeping your head on and just saying, okay, I have this opportunity. I feel the cramps. And this is also something that we look at post race. Why did you get the cramps? For me, I would predict that the reason you got the cramps was maybe because of the wetsuit, right? You might've been sweating in there more than you realize. The hills do definitely take it more out of your legs. And sometimes that alone can be the cramp causer, not necessarily electrolytes. So it could have been a combination of the both, right? Mm-hmm. But knowing, moving forward, what your next goal race is, which I think is just going to be flat, Miami Man, we don't have to worry about that stuff. as far as the hills, and you definitely have potential to go a lot faster on a completely flat course, you know?
Yeah,
for sure. So awesome. Congratulations. So when you crossed that finish line, how did you feel? Because knowing you hit your almost your exact time, like how did that feel when you crossed the finish line?
I mean, that was, it was a great feeling. It was, I was simultaneously so happy to be done. but also, you know, so happy that I had completed it after, you know, I signed up in May and got my base training going in the summer, but then really picked it up when we started working together in the late summer, and, you know, feeling all of that work that I'd put in come to fruition and, you know, get me across the finish line right when I wanted to. You know, despite having some challenges in the race, you know, it just, it was a great feeling.
Awesome. Congratulations. Super proud of you.
Thank you.
What are your goals? I already know your goals, but tell everybody else your goals for 2022.
So, well, one of them, I mean, for triathlon, it's, I'm kind of undecided. I think I probably want to do the Miami Man half iron distance next year.
Okay.
I would consider doing Haines City again if it were before Thanksgiving.
Right.
But I think
that's tough.
Yeah, having Miami Man before Thanksgiving is kind of the perfect time because it gets done and then you can enjoy the holidays and not have to worry about hitting a, you know, that was one of the peak parts of the training schedule was that week of Thanksgiving, which you know, not the most convenient thing. It's kind of like with the Miami half marathon or marathon, you're always hitting your 20 mile runs
during the holidays,
right around Christmas. And it's either you screw up the holidays or you you screw up for training.
Right. True.
But, you know, getting, certainly I want to try getting faster in the Olympic distance. I think that, you know, I will probably do half Ironmans in the future, but I think Olympic is the distance I want to focus on that.
Cool.
That's kind of the,
yeah, tell everybody you did get on the podium your first time for your Olympic in October, right?
But that was a sprint.
Oh, it was a sprint.
That was a sprint, yeah. That was the one, the Bill Bone triathlon up in Lake Worth.
That's right.
That came as a total shock to me. I mean, I had done the sprint, the last max cycle sprint distance, and was, I think, like eighth. Mm-hmm. And I knew I could go faster because that was my first race back since COVID, first triathlon in a couple years. So I was playing it safe in that race, kind of just getting back into the feeling of racing. And I knew I could go faster.
Yeah.
So I pushed it more in Lake Worth and finished the race. And my wife and I were standing around. I'm like, let me just check the results to see if we need to stick around for the medal ceremony. And I was first place in my age group.
Yay!
Which was a total shock to me. And then Miami Man, I think I was either eighth or ninth, something like that, you know, not too far off the podium spots wise, but I think I was 5 or 6 minutes away from third place. So
okay, cool.
Definitely some improvement to do if I want to get on the podium at that distance. But I was going to say, I think that's kind of the sweet spot distance for me It's long enough that it's a real physical and mental challenge. You know, it's 2 hours, a little bit more for me.
Right.
But not so long and grueling as the half Ironman, which, like I said, I'll continue to consider doing in the future, but I think the Olympic is kind of where I want to focus.
I love that.
And also running a half marathon in under an hour and 40. Yeah.
Okay, cool. So I think both of those are super achievable, and I'm super excited that you want to go fast and shorter before you maybe go back to longer, because it makes going longer faster easier.
Mm-hmm.
If you go faster, shorter, you're much more likely to hit your longer, faster goals, right? So I love that, that those are your goals. And there are some amazing, fun Olympic distance triathlons all over Florida, or even traveling, you know? So that's kind of a cool thing that you can tap into. And then if you did want to think about like a half Ironman in the fall, like I know I have a couple athletes doing Cozumel, and then North Carolina is also a flat, fast half Ironman. So those are some options just to put in the back of your head if you didn't want to do Miami Man, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Well, I'm super proud of you, excited
Thank
for
you.
Your accomplishments, and well-deserved. You are the Rockstar Triathlete of the Week. So his email is going to be coming out with all the details. So anything else you want to share, Ben?
I mean, nothing that comes to mind. I'm glad I found this group. I'm glad I found you as a coach. I think it's been a really good fit. As far as improving my form, like you said, improving on the little things, I had a good base of fitness and of race experience coming in, but it's those little tweaks that can really make a big difference, from just finishing the race to really excelling. Yeah. So, you know, I'm excited to keep improving, keep working on my form and keep racing.
Awesome. Me too, Ben. All right. Well, happy holidays. Wishing you well.
Thank you. Happy holidays to you and everyone watching.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.